Thank you. Thank you for the introduction. It's my pleasure to talk about prostate MRI. And thank you for inviting me to speak. I have no disclosures. And as mentioned, the objectives, I'm going to talk about the role of prostate MR, showing some of the scientific evidence. But before that, I'll talk about PRIORAD's version 2.1 and also present areas of investigation and where we're heading with regards to prostate MRI. So prostate MRI has been around for decades, coming well into the third decade, and been around longer than the residents before they were even born. Even with the mustaches on, I can tell you, quite young. So this is all happening before you were born in the 80s. And that's where the cell phone started in the 80s. As you can tell, it was quite bulky. It is a cell phone. It was used for making phone calls, which is maybe something you don't do as often these days. MRI still looks the same, okay? But things have changed. Back in that time when it was first rolled out, it was really for staging. We only had T1 weighted sequences looking for post biopsy hemorrhage, which is a bright white dot there. And T2 weighted sequences looking at anatomy. You can see a normal peripheral zone, transition zone, and looking to see if there's extra prostatic extension. In this case, you see a tumor in the left mid gland encasing the neurovascular bundle. So, with improved technology, we've also developed new techniques, what's called multiparametric MRI, where in addition to the standard T1 and T2 weighted sequences, you have functional sequences. An example is diffusion weighted sequence, which is now a critical part of prostate MRI. And this is something we actually worked on back in the day in 2006. We were one of the first to investigate this and showed that it actually performed better than T2 alone. And when you combine it with dynamic contrast imaging, it does perform better than any sequence alone. MR spectroscopy was also around in the early 2000s, but that's kind of dropped off because in terms of practicality, it's just not there in terms of acquisition and processing time. And it's just not as practical as diffusion weighted imaging, which is really a critical sequence today. So what is diffusion weighted imaging? As the name implies, it has to do with detecting diffusion. As we know, Brownian motion of water, Brownian motion within and in out extracellular, intracellular spaces. So in cases where there is tumor, where there is increased number of cells, where there's cytotoxic edema, as in stroke, this is where diffusion weighted imaging first came into clinical use, or situations where an abscess, increased viscosity, there's decreased motion, random motion, and MRI can detect that. So this is what multiparametric MRI encompasses. You have T2 weighted sequences, your top left is axial T2, then the bottom two is your sagittal and coronal plane, those are all T2. You have the DWI, and the ADC is part of the DWI. It's a post-process image. It kind of helps to kind of assess for restricted diffusion because DWI can give you some artifact. Areas that are bright indicate restricted diffusion, but in some cases, cysts can also mimic restricted diffusion. So you want your ADC map to confirm you see restricted diffusion. So you want a bright dot on the DWI sequence, a dark spot on the ADC. And then dynamic contrast is also utilized. So that's your multiparametric MRI. And now with all these advances, MRI is not only used for local staging, but certainly can help in the detection of clinically significant cancer, localization of cancer, and characterization of cancer to help risk stratify, help determine best management for patients. It is also being used to assess for recurrent disease and also help guide patients for focal therapy, as well as assess the management or outcomes of focal therapy. So with all this increase in utilization of prostate MRI, you can imagine the kind of diversity in how to acquire it, how to interpret it, and that led to a standardized reporting system, which is called PIRATS, Prostate Imaging Reporting and Data System. It was first introduced through the group of Society of Uroradiologists in 2012. It has since been refined and revised. We had a version 2 that was updated and launched at RSNA 2014. And more recently, this spring in March, it was electronically released as an updated version 2.1. So we're on the third version of PIRATS. It's an ongoing evolving document. At some point, we'll probably roll out PIRATS version 3, but not quite yet. So there's still a lot of work to be done, but in terms of PIRATS criteria, it really classifies the likelihood of prostate cancer. So a PIRATS lesion, PIRATS 1 lesion is very low clinically significant. Cancer to be present, PIRATS 2 is low risk, PIRATS 3 is indeterminate, PIRATS 4 is high risk of clinically significant cancer, and PIRATS 5 is very high risk. So with the recent updates, there was a lot that was touched upon. It included technique and interpretation, which is what the document includes. Basically, T2, it mentions, which sequences are critical. Axial is critical, and another orthogonal plane is important. Your DWI just kind of fine-tunes the details in terms of b-values and how to acquire. Dynamic contrast is not as important as T2 and DWI, so also they kind of lower the threshold in terms of the contrast. You don't have to run it as quickly. They also have guidelines on how to measure the prostate gland. You're supposed to measure the transverse and the axial plane, the AP and the sagittal plane, and cranial caudal and the sagittal plane. It also recommends that you talk about central zone and anterior fibromuscular stroma as well. Transition zone, I'll kind of show you some examples where there's kind of change, and there's certain situations where you can upgrade a transition zone nodule from a Pi-RADS 2 to a Pi-RADS 3. Dynamic contrast we already talked about, and the sector map has also been revised slightly, and I'll show you an image of that. So in terms of technique, as mentioned, Pi-RADS includes technique. Technique is critical in addition to interpretation. You want to make sure you have a high-quality examination, certainly makes it easier to interpret. So 1.5 versus 3T. 3T is recommended, but you can certainly do it at 1.5, and we have a 1.5 magnet that does really well even without an endovascular coil. So what about the coil? The coil, the dreaded coil that the patients really dislike. And they say that coil is not required at 3T. And even at 5T, if you have a state-of-the-art imaging with at least 16 channels, here's an image of a 3T. And then another patient where we have the same patient where we have 1.5 with the coil and a 1.5 without the coil. And you can see the small little dots in. Actually, is there a pointer on here? No. Oh. Also, it's linked. Oh, sorry, I didn't know that. Great. Okay. Yeah. So you can see this little tumor. Oops. Back in here. Yeah. So even without the coil, you can see this little tumor in the midgland. Okay. So what about the coil? There's been studies that looked at coil. Fortunately, in most of the studies, it was a group that did have the coil, a group that did not have the coil. Not many studies have done the same patient with and without coil. We were probably one or two or three that only did it. So we looked at our sensitivity and specificity. This is for clinically significant prostate cancer, so group grade two or greater. And we found that overall the coil did perform better than without a coil. It was clinically significant in one reader, but not so much in the other reader. So coil does improve your performance, but it wasn't significant in one reader, but in the other. What we found was it did find all the greater than 3+4. It did miss a couple of 3+4. So in this group of patients, we had about 30, 22 patients, maybe. I can't remember if it was 100 lesions or so. So there were 13 of them that were 3+4 tumors. All the 13 were picked up with a coil. 3T plus coil. There were four lesions that were not picked up without the coil. One was in the transition zone, which is kind of a tough area to assess. The other three were actually quite small lesions. They were 1 cm or less. And pathologically, they turned out to be atrophic tissue, infarct, and prostatitis. So those are kind of mimickers of prostate cancer. And this is one of our examples where on the top you can see there's no without the coil, you didn't see the obvious lesion in the right midline. Whereas with the coil, you can see a little dark spot on T2 and some restricted diffusion in the right midline. In this study, we also looked at ADC values because ADC value is a nice objective measure just to see in terms of response to therapy. And we looked to see if ADC values changed or not with or without the coil. And as you can see here, there was no statistical difference. And this is good to know because a patient who actually initially went the imaging with a coil, then had treatment and subsequent gets a follow-up without a coil. If you use ADC as a marker, then you kind of reassure that there isn't really going to be any difference just based on changes in technique. The other study that I've been working on, this is through the SAAR Prostate Disease Focus Group, is just practice patterns. As we know, the MRI is increasing utilization. It's nice to know where the challenges and patterns in practice in MRI. A lot of the participants in this study were from the United States. So as you can see, the majority of them have access to 3T MRI, 82%, compared to us in Canada. We mainly image at 1.5. You can see that a lot of people do not use the endorectal coil, so that's the pattern of practice. Certainly in the States is 3T, no endorectal coil. Obviously follow the high B value, which is critical. Sometimes you can extrapolate if your magnet doesn't kind of acquire a nice high B value. You can use computer software to kind of process images for that. And as you can see, if people use contrast, contrast is pretty easy to use, but there's always concerns about gadolinium deposition in some patients, you know, at risk with renal function and so forth. As you can see, spectroscopy, majority of people do not use spectroscopy. So practice in North America, certainly in Americans, is 3T without coil, no spectroscopy. So what about Pyrides version 2? Let's give you an idea of what a radiologist goes through when they open up a prostate MRI study. So when you see a lesion, you have to determine, is it in the peripheral zone or is it in the transition zone? If it's in the peripheral zone, the dominant sequence is going to be the DWI that gives you the overall Pyrides score, though you do give a score for each of DWI, T2, and dynamic contrast. If the lesion is in the transition zone, then the key sequence to identify its overall Pyrides score is a T2 weighted sequence, but you also must look at the DWI, and contrast doesn't really change the overall scoring of the transition zone lesion. So here's Pyrides. So in terms of peripheral zone lesion, there's criteria for T2. And a T2 score of 1 is just uniform hyperintense signal in the peripheral zone. So in terms of anatomy, this is nice normal peripheral zone. This is the endorectal coil, and this is the transition zone. And then for Pyrides version 2, it's wedge-shaped and linear, and this is often what you see as prostatitis, okay? And sometimes scarring, it's usually linear, it's not rounded, doesn't have mass effect. Pyrides 3 has heterogeneous signal intensity, not quite wedge-shaped, but not totally, obviously, mass-like. So when you're kind of sitting on the fence, you can't really slough it off as prostatitis, but you don't really want to miss a cancer, then Pyrides 3 would be your category here. Pyrides 4 is well circumscribed, homogeneous, it's quite moderately dark on T2, confined to the prostate gland, and measures less than 1.5 centimeters. There's a Pyrides 5, similar appearance of Pyrides 4, but the only difference is it measures greater than 1.5 centimeters, or there's obvious extraprostatic extension or invasive type of behavior. So this is peripheral zone scoring on T2. T2 in the transition zone is different. You can have normal pairing transition zone where it's just all kind of not quite homogeneous, but kind of organized chaos, if you will. And then you can have a really discrete BPH nodule, as you can see here in the coronal plane, very sharp lines around it. So that's normal transition zone. Pyrides 2 in the transition zone is partially encapsulated, as shown here. You can see this nodule here is encapsulated anteriorly, but a little bit ill-defined posteriorly. So that's a Pyrides 2. And this is also a Pyrides 2. It doesn't have the dark encapsulated line behind it, but it's homogeneously kind of dark like this. It doesn't have the little stromal glands in it. And that's also a Pyrides 2. So this is peripheral zone, which is nice and bright on T2, and this is all transition zone here. Pyrides 3 is when it's slightly ill-defined, but not enough to call a Pyrides 4, as here, it's kind of slightly ill-defined, not obviously like a BPH nodule, like the nodule right behind it, is that would be like a Pyrides 1. Well, here's Pyrides 4. Classically, they're lenticular in shape, as shown here. They're homogeneous. It doesn't have the high T2 glandular elements in it, and it's moderately hypointense and has kind of ill-defined margins. Some call it the eraser smudge charcoal sign. And a Pyrides 5 is similar, except it exceeds or it is 1.5 centimeters or greater, or this obvious extraprostatic or invasive type appearances. So now you've looked at it on T2, then you have to look at the lesion on DWI. DWI is if there's no area of restriction. So on a DWI image, you want to look for a bright white spot, and you don't see a bright white spot there. For a Pyrides 2, it restricts, but it's wedge-shaped. So that's why it's a 2 and not anything higher, meaning it's probably prostatitis. Pyrites 3, basically it's slightly brighter or darker in the background, but it's not brighter than anything else in the gland. So kind of subtle restricted diffusion, as shown here. It's a little bit dark on the left image. On the right, it doesn't really stand out as much. Whereas pyrites 4, and the reason I wrote no change in there, it meant that there's no change from the last version. So a lot of the changes of the pyrites 2.1 comes in the diffusion, which is really helpful because it's made diffusion a little bit more easier to classify. Before, it was a little bit kind of difficult to give a score of a 3 or a 4. The current 2.1 makes it easier to call it a 4. You want it to be the darkest thing on ADC and the brightest thing on the DWI. As shown here, the lesion label is 4. You can see it's quite dark on ADC, and on the B value, it's brighter than the pyrites 3 lesion. The 5, again, no change from prior. It's disc measures greater than 1.5 centimeters, and there's evidence of extraprostatic invasive behavior. So look how strongly this lesion restricts. And then this is what it looked like on T2. So on T2, it could be overlooked, and this is where DWI can really help identify lesions in the transition zone, which are really tricky to pick up. Okay, so what about contrast? Contrast is considered negative if there's no early enhancement, meaning it doesn't enhance earlier than the rest of the gland. And then what's considered positive? Oh, sorry, below it's just a prior version. So right now for the current version, they're saying that there's no early enhancement, as shown here. You see this lesion with the arrow on the left side, the pyrites 3 lesion, but it doesn't enhance, so it stays a pyrites 3. And what about a score of positive? Basically, as shown here, you can see there's early enhancement. So this is a lesion on T2, it's dark on T2, but it demonstrates early enhancement. So that's considered positive enhancement. All right, so now that you have all these findings, so you have a lesion, let's say in the peripheral zone, you wanna give it a T2 score. Then you give it a DWI score. What's outlined in red is the updates on the version 2.1. What's in black is the 2.0 version. The updates overall were considered minor, which is why it was given 2.1 rather than pyrites 3. It was given a version 2.1. And then you want to see if it enhances or not. So as mentioned in the purple zone, the key sequence is the DWI. So if there's nothing restricting, it doesn't matter what anything else shows. It's a pyrites 1. Same thing, if you call it a DWI score of 2, then it stays a pyrites 2. If you give it a score of 3, it could only be upgraded if there's enhancement, and that's how you get a score of 4. Okay. So sometimes the reports you'll see are reports stating pyrites 4 in brackets 3 plus 1. That you know it wasn't that, you know, obviously restricting wasn't that suspicious, but the contrast bumps it up to a 3 plus 4, meaning that potentially could be prostatitis rather than an outright clinically significant cancer. If the DWI score is 4, it stays a 4 throughout. If the DWI score, is 5, it stays a 5 throughout. So this is your overall score. Now, if the lesion is in the transition zone, T2 is a critical sequence. So if it looks totally normal, like a totally benign BPH nodule, it stays a 1. If it's partially encapsulated, and it restricts really strongly, then it gets bumped up to a 3. So in order to get a DWI score, as mentioned, a DWI score of 4 has to be really dark on ADC, really bright on DWI. And in that case, it bumps it up to a 3. So that's one of the major changes in pyrites 2.1. It makes it a little bit easier to score the transition zone and more standardization of it, because there is variability when we read these prostate MRIs. Even in experts, the agreement is only moderate. The Kappa score is 0.6, even in expert readers. So this helps to kind of standardize assessment in transition zone, which can be quite tricky. So in terms of the other scores, we know that a score of 3 can be bumped up to a 4 if there's a large airway restricted fusion that measures 1.5 centimeters or greater, okay? And then a score of 4 stays a 4, a score of 5 stays a 5. So this is kind of something that we always have handy or in the back of our minds when we're grading a prostate lesion to give it an overall score. Okay, so even with the scoring system, it still works in progress. As part of the prostate disease-focused panel of the Society of Abdominal Radiology, which I'm a member, we decided to do a multi-center trial, retrospectively looking at all our data. This involved 29 centers, over 5,000 lesions. As you can see, the breakdown scores of PI-RADS, there were a lot as PI-RADS 3. Most of them were called PI-RADS 4. There were some PI-RADS 5. This was all matched with the targeted fusion biopsy. And you can see there's various Gleason scores here. And we had some area on the curve values of 74%. And sensitivity and specificity for detecting clinically significant cancer scores. If a score of 3, it was a sensitivity of 97, specificity of 17, quite low. Score of greater than 4, sensitivity of 81%, and specificity of 54%. So basically, if in clinically significant cancers, 8% of the lesions were assigned a score of 2, 19% had a score of 3, 40% had a score of 4, and 73% had a score of 5, so there is correlation. Overall, there was high sensitivity, but the specificity was low, something that we, you know, it would have been nice if it was better. Part of it probably was because it was very varied. It was 29 centers, and even though we were considered experienced in the field, we weren't the only ones reading these reports, right? There were obviously, you know, many people in many centers, so there's variability in interpretation. So what came out of it was basically if a lesion was scored less than PI-RADS 3, then probably patient doesn't need to proceed to targeted biopsy since the chance of clinically significant cancer was going to be less than 5%.
I wonder if the lack of sensitivity due to specificity due to just the lack of targeting or maybe the biopsy procedure itself.
Yeah, that's a good point because this is a retrospective study. And in the States, the majority of the biopsies are performed by urologists. So then you also have radiologists read them and urologists perform. So there's wide variability in this. So yeah, that's a good point. That's probably one of the reasons as well. Okay, so prostate carcinoma. So PI-RADS 2, that was PI-RADS 2 data, of course, because PI-RADS 2.1 just rolled out. So obviously, more work needs to be done. So prostate MRI, unfortunately, you know, with stark on T2 isn't always cancer. You have to think that, you know, it could be post-biopsy hemorrhage, radiation, hormone treatment, inflammation, and dystrophic changes can also mimic cancer, as shown here. Just showing some examples of PI-RADS 2, again, the stromal BPH nodule back here. You can see it in the sagittal and coronal plane. It is a bit dark on ADC here, but it's not brighter than anything here. It's not that bright, and there isn't much enhancement. So basically, this becomes stays a PI-RADS 2, and this was targeted biopsy negative. All right, so as shown here, the DWI score would have been a 3 here, so it stays at 2. Now, what about this lesion? It's not your classic BPH nodule where you've got that dark rim around it, but it's very restricting, very dark on ADC, very bright on DWI. So this is a lesion that we call a 2 on T2. It's a 4 on DWI, becomes a PI-RADS 3. This went for biopsy and came back as 4+3. Another PI-RADS 3 lesion with our current version upgraded to a PI-RADS 3. Again, not your classic BPH nodule. Doesn't have that sharp rim around it. Restricts really strongly on ADC and DWI. So again, this is another case where you have a 3 PI-RADS 2. The DWI is 4, it's upgraded to 3. Now this one came back as a 3+3. And it wasn't much different from the prior lesion, which was a 4+3. So it's hard to sometimes know exactly what the Gleason score can be. Hopefully with advancing techniques and areas of research with AI and radiomics, maybe that will help kind of fine tune things a little bit more. Okay, so what about this lesion? Is this a cancer? bit of a leading question. So here it is. It's dark on T2. Does look like it shows some restriction, but it's not really bright here. And then this is looks like it's in the peripheral zone. So if it's in the peripheral zone, you really have to have strong restriction. So it could be called a pyrites 3 because it doesn't have an outright 4 appearance. And it doesn't enhance, so like you can't bump it up to a 4. So this was biopsy, and it came back as central zone. So just an example to show that prostate MRI isn't easy to interpret, and you can encounter lesions that can mimic cancer. And central zone usually identifies as here. So that's why it's important to actually also image in the orthogonal planes, like sagittal or coronal, to make sure you're not overcalling disease. So the central zone shown here, it kind of has that symmetric space, and it also has been described as kind of a mustache shape appearance as well, triangular or teardrop area shown here. And then what about this lesion? Similar to the prior lesion, a bit dark on T2 here, shows a bit of restriction. The restriction looks a bit stronger, and it has hyperenhancement. And this is actually a cancer. And the clue here was that it restricted a little bit strongly, and it had early enhancement. So you have to be careful not to miss it and think it's just prostate central zone. So this is where maybe contrast does have its benefit as well. And we know that central zone cancers tend to be more aggressive with higher Gleason scores, invade the seminal vesicle with extraprostatic extension, and higher risk of recurrence. So you don't want to miss these types of tumors. All right. Another pitfall is the androfibromuscular stroma. So in the turquoise arrows, you can see it's quite dark on T2, and that's just a slice below. These are just kind of almost consecutive slices. And it's really dark on ADC, but not bright on DWI, and that's what anterofibromuscular stroma looks like, and it doesn't enhance. But you can see how it can mimic tumor because it's dark on T2 and dark on ADC, but you need to be bright on DWI. In contrast to this lesion, this restricts really strongly with the white arrow, and that was a pyrites 4, and that came back as a Gleason 3+4. And you can see that it enhances quite a bit. Another example of potential pitfall lesions is prostatitis, as shown here, an area that's dark in the purple zone, shows some restricted diffusion and enhances. And this came back as negative for malignancy and showed inflammation. Just another case, again, sometimes it can be more extensive. As shown here, you can see this lesion that's quite dark. And it shows a bit of restriction and enhances quite avidly, and it's quite focal. So that can totally mimic tumor, but it's important to actually look at the other planes. When you look at the sagittal plane, it actually shows evidence of atrophic changes here. It's quite much smaller than the contralateral side, which is more bulky. So this was prospectively called prostatitis. He needed a biopsy anyways on kind of clinical grounds, and it came back negative. Okay, so those are some of the features of prostatitis can mimic cancer. And here is a patient. You see this every now and then, a patient with a rising PSA negative prostate biopsy, and you do an MRI to rule out an anterozone lesion. And certainly here he has with an anterozone lesion. So these transition zone lesions can be tough to spot on T2, as you can see, but you can identify it with restricted diffusion, area of really dark restriction here, and hyperenhancement. This patient went to fusion biopsy. So this is a sector map, and the update on version 2.1 is that they've identified additional zones in the peripheral zone of the base. They've divided now into medial and lateral segments. So you have 41 regions, 38 in the prostate, 2 are the seminal vesicles, and 1 is the external sphincter. So you mark it on the spot there, and then the patient undergoes a fusion biopsy and comes back as 3+4 involving the majority of the targets. All right. So in terms of prostate MRI, certainly the AUA and SAR have supported its use in men who have prior negative biopsy, was still a concern that there could be a cancer still there. And then there's other studies, level 1A studies that looked at prostate MRI. This is a multi-center study with paired cohort. They looked at multi-parametric MRI versus systematic biopsy. They used the transperineal template biopsy as a reference standard at 576 patients. They found 71% had prostate cancer and 40% were clinically significant. They found the sensitivity in identifying these clinically significant prostate cancer with MRI was 93%, which is much higher than chest biopsy, which is 41%. The specificity was not as great, though. The specificity was greater in the chest biopsies. So here's MRI showing that it certainly has much greater sensitivity in picking up clinically significant cancer, but lower specificity. So in this study, showed that 27% of the men were able to avoid biopsy, and it was able to identify 18% more clinically significant cancer and 5% less of clinically insignificant cancer. So that's the PROMISE study. Precision study, well-known study, 25 centers, 11 countries, randomized, again, multiparametric MRI versus chest biopsy, 500 patients, equally distributed into MRI, almost equally, and systematic biopsy. MRI identified 28% were negative, did not need to go to biopsy. The rest here went to targeted biopsy, finding 38% clinically significant cancer in these 95 patients. Chest biopsy picked up 26% clinically significant cancer. So with the MRI, you're picking up more clinically significant cancer. MRI first study, this was all done in France in 16 centers. The patients underwent a systematic biopsy. But before that, they had a MRI, and then if the MRI was positive, they also had a targeted biopsy. In that systematic biopsy, they also biopsied anything that they could see was echo-poor. So 251 patients, 21% were negative, did not have cancer. In the patients that had clinically significant cancer, there was not 37% in this group. Systematic biopsy picked up 14% of the cancers only, so only systematic biopsies were detected cancer in these patients. In another group, these were targeted biopsy. Targeted biopsy was only picked up in 20% of patients was only picked up in targeted biopsy, whereas both in systematic and targeted biopsy, it was positive in 66%. So this is basically saying that there really was no difference in detection of clinically significant prostate cancer with systematic and targeted biopsy, but they showed that combining both techniques certainly showed substantial value in detecting clinically significant cancer, and that's why many centers are now still doing systematics with the targeted biopsies, though there's also data out there that was presented at recent ISMRM saying that no, you can do targets only and not and forego the systematics, but obviously more research needs to be done on this. And then the 4M study, this is a multi-center study. They looked at MRI, and if it was positive, they would go to MRI-guided biopsy. Patients also underwent systematic biopsy, and you can find that in terms of identifying clinically significant cancer. In this study, they found that it's actually fairly equal in terms of identifying clinically significant cancer, but with MRI, you were able to identify less clinically insignificant cancer in this study. So as you know, in Europe, this is really the practice. They're doing MRIs prior to biopsy. So basically in this patient, almost half the men did not have a suspicious MRI. I think in this sort of study, it had to do with the center. These are very experienced centers, so they, I guess, read the MRIs as half of them not needing a biopsy, but they did say that not performing a chest biopsy was at a cost of potentially missing clinically significant cancer in 4% of men. So there's also a Crockton review on this. They looked at the four different pathways. One was basically just a systematic biopsy. The other one was doing the MRI, the other one was MRI and targeted biopsy, and then you had the MRI pathway, and the reference standard was a templated biopsy. And these are the results here. So you can see the sensitivity here was highest in the MRI alone, Specificity was highest in the systematic biopsy, and it was felt that the MRI pathway was probably the best performance overall. So what about the views of our American colleagues south of the border? As some, or probably most of you know, this was just released last month, and Americans are on board now. They are supporting MRI prior to biopsy in man consideration for biopsy, okay? Currently insufficient data for screening in men or in active surveillance. So how does Canada feel about this? And just recently, there's been an opinion piece in the Canadian Medical Association Journal saying that, yes, there are randomized control studies that support the use of MRI prior to biopsy, but we have to be careful. In a universal healthcare system, there are resource issues, so there's challenges to access to MRI. And then secondly is the inter-observer variability. As mentioned, Kappa score is 0.6, even in experienced readers. As you can see, when I showed you the PI-RADS scheme, they're not easy studies to interpret. Sometimes even tricky to get even a good quality study in certain patients. So those are the issues. And I would say, you know, this came out of Toronto, and I would say it probably applies the same in BC. The main issues are access and quality. I talked about a little bit about this too. Maybe last year, Alan set up a journal club, and some of you might have been there. So in terms of BC, access and quality are main issues. Access is a big issue in Canada. We have long wait lists. BC is very unique. We have, in terms of MRI, we have block funding for MRI, and that's a big issue. In terms of BC compared to other provinces, we do 30 to 45% less studies than other provinces, and that has to do with the way we are funded. Wait times can be as long as 41 days and even over a year for certain patients. Northern Health Authority got first place for longest wait times all across Canada. Fraser Health was probably a close second. So major issues in terms of access in BC. We know Adrian Dix is trying to fix that. In the last year, $11 million has been helped to fund this. It basically had 10 of our 33 publicly funded MRIs running 24/7, increasing scanner time, hiring more technologists, and obviously this amounted to an increase of 43,993 scans, an increase rate of 23% overall. His plan is to, you know, donate more money with the aim to have additional scans, estimated around $15,000. I think it was block everything MRI. It's my understanding. Everything from using the IV tubing to the syringe to the endorectal coil, probably tech salary, everything MRI. Yeah. No, prostate MRIs are over a year. Yeah, so in that survey that I did about challenges, chest patterns in North America, we had wait times of over a year and a half. And my American colleagues were like, don't you mean like 1.5 days, not 1.5 years? I don't know, it's 1.5 years. They don't have wait times, they don't know that definition. So, and then just touching on this extra billing, as you know, this was over a year ago, October 1st, 2018, Adrian Dix said he was gonna just do away with extra billings. At that time, there were 17 private clinics. I know two of them were purchased into the funded stream in Fraser Health. So maybe right now there's maybe 15 private clinics. Currently, this is still ongoing. So we're still scanning at private clinics. I know that this is being challenged in the courts. Certainly, our surgical colleagues are doing this. We're just kind of watching, waiting to see what happens. And I guess what happens there will probably what happens to radiology as well. So we'll sit and wait. So as mentioned, so access is an issue. Quality is another issue. Technique, you wanna make sure you've got a good technique so you can interpret these. As you can see, interpreting can be quite challenging and there's variability as well in the pyrides reads. As you know, Peter and I who run prostate rounds, you can see the reads can be variable depending on different sites. Okay? And so that's the thing. It's a ripple effect. You start introducing prostate MRI, then you have to do targeted fusion biopsies. And right now, not many centers in DC are doing that. So again, you need the capital funds and program and operational costs to perform fusion biopsy. It takes more work, more time than regular systematic biopsies. So you need to incorporate that into your workflow as well. A fusion biopsy takes much longer than the systematic biopsy because of the preparation time. You need to contour and you need to review that MRI and double check things, where systematic, you pretty much just go in there and do the biopsies. So what are the ways to kind of improve on this? How are we going to kind of get more patients in there? There's one way is to do this, but this probably won't go very well. So what are we going to do? What about shortened protocols? People have been talking about no contrast, because you know in pyrides, contrast is not as critical as T2 and DWI. And what about new MRI techniques? Most of the studies out there are showing that maybe we can get away with contrast. The study on your right is showing that, oh, well, you know, it does really have its benefits and maybe we should keep it. So in terms of studies, a lot of these studies were retrospective, this meta-analysis, but it did show that sensitivity was very similar. So the left middle column is your multiparametric and the column on your far right is your biparametric, meaning without the contrast. So biparametric meaning T2 and DWI with your ADC map. You can see the sensitivity and specificity are pretty much the same, as well as the ROC analysis. So what about our experience? So we looked at our experience because we do 1.5 orthotic coil, which is considered unique compared to American cohorts. So we read this, myself and Emily. So we looked at sensitivity, which increased with contrast, but we found that accuracy and specificity was reduced when we used contrast. We also found that clinically significant cancer was missed when we, I guess we missed one without contrast. However, even with contrast, we also miss some lesions as well. So overall cancer detection rate certainly increased with the use of DCE, but most were insignificant cancers. So what we've done with this is, this is just a prelim data of, I believe, 75 patients and 105 lesions. We are kind of a third of the way into this, and hopefully we'll have more robust data. But currently what we're doing is just to get more patients in there. And some of our patients who are coming up for follow-up study, we're kind of leaving out the contrast part of it just to get patients through quicker. These patients get in, they're coming in at 3 in the morning when, you know, we don't have the ability to contrast for various reasons. Okay, so biparametric MRI, where are we? The data is kind of supporting it in biopsy-naive men with negative biopsy. Other data shows it serves as a safety net, which is good in patients who have hip prosthesis. It's kind of nice to have the contrast study because with hip prosthesis, it obscures the DWI sequence, makes it very suboptimal. More research is needed. And most recently, I'm aware that the European Association of Urology has approved a grant for a prospective multicenter trial on basically the benefit of contrast or necessity of contrast. So in terms of multiparametric MRI, so when would you do it, when would you give contrast? In terms of the latest pyrides version 2, they would say that in patients where the clinical priority of not missing clinically significant cancer, so basically patients have prior negative biopsy and unexplained rise in PSA, or patients on active surveillance with fast PSA doubling times, or changing clinical pathologic profile. Previous negative biparametric MRI, but you're still worried, then you go give contrast on the repeat study. Prior prostate intervention, any focal therapy, you need the contrast for sure, currently. And biopsy in naive men with strong family history or known genetic predispositions, elevated urine genomic scores, above average risk, consider contrast in these men. So as mentioned, technique is can be a problem, and rectal gas can be a real problem for DWI sequences. The red arrow is a lesion in the peripheral zone. You don't see it on DWI because the rectal gas basically just wipes away the zone. It's basically obliterated, it's artifacts, so you can't really assess the lesion. There's also distortion. If you look at this, you have a nodule here in the transition zone posteriorly, and you can see the peripheral zone behind it. But with the rectal gas, it basically artifactuates out the peripheral zone, and this nodule looks like it's actually peripheral zone next to the rectum. So you get image, you get distortion as well. You can see that the gland here in the AP dimension is thicker, whereas on DWI it's skinnier. So you can actually get caught off and misregister lesions and misinterpret your MRI. There was an abstract at SAR that showed that enema did have benefits in this, and that's what we're doing in our patients, is recommending they have an enema before they come for the MRI. So basically, enema at home, drive in, we get you onto the magnet. In some centers, if there's still rectal gas on the table, the tech will have them to, you know, evacuate the gas. In some centers, someone will actually put in a Foley catheter to evacuate the gas. We've done it once. Thank you, Hamid, for doing that. It worked. It made a big difference. I meant to show these images for the credit, because it was great, because they actually got images with the gas and without afterwards. So thank you very much. No. And same thing, the MRI techs, that's why they went into MRI, right? They went away from fluoro and enemas. So, and this is just an image showing how ADC, how a hip replacement can really make the diffusion really suboptimal. So the whole left side of the gland is totally obscured. You can see it on T2, you can see it on contrast and T1, but with diffusion, there is really a limitation. So this is just a post RDM embolization. This is kind of recently new, and some of the centers are doing more and more. This just showing that infarcts occur. It's a known thing. It tends to occur in the transition zone only, and it starts to kind of dissipate over time. But that's the typical thing to see, is an infarct, and not to confuse it with tumor, because it could mimic a tumor because it's so dark, but we know that it doesn't enhance. And usually we're provided a history of prostate artery embolization, so we can figure out it's an infarct. And just finishing up here on new techniques, luminal water imaging is something that we've been working on with Piotr Kozlowski, our MRI physicist. So luminal water is basically a T2 type sequence. It's basically a T2 type sequence that's a longer sequence. It takes about 11 minutes versus a regular T2 sequence, which is about 4 minutes. But you're looking at all these other types of functional techniques. And basically the clue here is that with tumor, there's going to be less lumen, and the MRI can actually detect the water, the luminal space. So less luminal space implies more cancer, and it seems to be correlating with Gleason score as well. So on this image here, the red arrow denotes cancer here, and you can see that there's actually that's normal tissue, and then there's the cancer, and you see that there's less luminal water with the cancer lesion here on the left side. So that's your cancer, and there's less luminal water in this peak. So we were and then of all these different parameters, this is beyond the scope of this talk, but basically luminal water was the best indicator. And we showed that it performed really well comparing it to contrast and DWI, which we were happy that we published in radiology. So in terms of the area under the curves, we can see that it performs quite well, better in the peripheral and transition zone. So we also then compared it. This is preliminary data that we submitted to ISMRM. So we looked at comparing luminal water with our clinical read 2.1, which is the latest version, and it's showing it's performing similarly well. In terms of area on the curve, it performs 0.94, whereas the Pyrides read version 2.1, 0.92. Sensitivities somewhat not as great in the whole gland, but in terms of the peripheral zone, similar, and similar in the transition zone. So this is kind of preliminary data. Just with one reader, we're going to have to incorporate the second reader in there as well. And going back to that contrast study that I was reading with my colleague, the Kappa score was that we actually looked at our Kappa scores. Our Kappa score was 0.5. Just finishing with 7T, early data, 7T was really small. Early data we did, we looked at ex vivo. This is actually in vivo of real patients on 3T. The top row is your 7T, the bottom row is your 3T. These are two different patients with the whole mounts below. You can see with 7T, you're getting better images. But you have to be careful. I mean, this is just the T2-weighted sequences. I suspect maybe on the diffusion, there may be more artifact, prone to artifact. This is always give and take, but this is early. So 7T is probably coming. I'm not sure exactly when it's going to be coming. Not anytime soon here, because we're still waiting for 3T. So hopefully 7T in my lifetime, we'll see. So artificial, okay, you can't talk about radiology without talking about artificial intelligence. So basically right now, it's works in progress. It's new in terms of prostate MRI. The task that are involved is detecting lesion for you and also trying to classify the type of aggressiveness of the lesion. And there is a recent study from radiology showing that they were able to show that artificial intelligence can detect and classify lesion just as well as an experienced radiologist. So that does not mean that it's going to replace us. It is just going to help us. Okay, it's going to decrease our interpretation time, so you'll get your report out sooner to you. It will increase performance certainly in less experienced readers, enable large screening practices, and hope to decrease inter-observer variability. So this goes down to where we're heading with AI. It's certainly going to help us, but can we go even more brief with the MRI imaging? So the study looked at axial T2 and DWI alone and said it performed just as well as biparametric and multiparametric. So basically, this is what we're doing. T2, diffusion, and contrast. And then this biparametric, eliminating the contrast would be great, would certainly be cost savings. And you don't have to worry about the gadolinium deposition. And then the fast MRI, eliminating the sagittal and coronal T2, looking at just T2 and DWI. This would basically be a less than a 10-minute scan. And in very experienced readers, they're saying it performs just as well. So maybe with all this research, maybe that's where we're heading. Maybe quick sequences with AI to help us. And perhaps we can move to screening in patients and have what he called, my colleague Yella Barons has coined, the mammogram, essentially. So in conclusion, technical advances have really led to rapid utilization of MRI prostate. It's really exploded in the last few years, and that's led to some more standardized documentation known as PI-RADS, which is a language we use when we acquire, interpret, and report these images. Lots of ongoing research to further improve its performance in prostate cancer, and with that, I thank you for your attention.